The reading is taken from Exodus chapter 25, reading verses 1 to 40, and it can be found on page 83 of the Church Bibles. Page 83, chapter 25. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering for me from each man whose heart prompts him to give. These are the offerings you are to receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and fine linen, goat hair, ram skins, dyed red, and hides of sea cows, acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the fragrant incense, and onyx stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and breastpiece. Then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you. The ark. Have them make a chest of acacia wood, 2.5 cubits long, 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. Overlay it with pure gold, both inside and out, and make a gold molding around it. Cast 4 gold rings for it and fasten them to its 4 feet, with 2 rings on one side and 2 rings on the other. Then make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. Insert the poles into the rings on the sides of the chest to carry it. The poles are to remain in the rings of this ark. They are not to be removed. Then put in the ark the testimony which I will give you. Make an atonement cover of pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide, and make 2 cherubim out of hammered gold at the ends of the cover. Make 1 cherub on one end and the 2nd cherub on the other. Make the cherubim of 1 piece with the cover at the 2 ends. The cherubim are to have their wings spread upwards, overshadowing the cover with them. The cherubim are to face each other, looking towards the cover. Place the cover on top of the ark and put it in the ark, and put in the ark the testimony which I will give you. There, above the cover, between the 2 cherubim that are over the ark of the testimony, I will meet with you and give you all my commands for the Israelites. The table. Make a table of acacia wood, 2 cubits long, 1 cubit wide, and 1.5 cubits high. Overlay it with pure gold and make a gold molding around it. Also make around it a rim, 1 hand breadth wide, and put a gold molding on the rim. Make 4 gold rings for the table and fasten them to the 4 corners where the 4 legs are. The rings are to be close to the rim to hold the poles used in carrying the table. Make the poles of acacia wood, overlay them with gold and carry the table with them. And make its plates and dishes of pure gold, as well as its pitchers and bowls for the pouring out of offerings. Put the bread of the presence on this table to be before me at all times. The lampstand. Make a lampstand of pure gold and hammer it out, base and shaft. Its flower-like cups, buds, and blossoms shall be of 1 piece with it. 6 branches are to extend from the sides of the lampstand, 3 on one side and 3 on the other. 3 cups shaped like almond flowers with buds and blossoms are to be on 1 branch, three on the next branch, and the same for all six branches extending from the lampstand. And on the lampstand there are to be four cups, shaped like almond flowers with buds and blossoms. One bud shall be under the first pair of branches, extending from the lampstand. A second bud under the second pair, and a third bud under the third pair, six branches in all. The buds and branches shall all be of one piece with the lampstand, hammered out of pure gold. Then make it seven lamps and set them up on it so that they light the space in front of it. Its wick trimmers and trays are to be of pure gold. A talent of pure gold is to be used for the lampstand and all these accessories. See that you make them according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. 30th of November, that's my birthday, in case you're wondering. As younger youth head out for their teaching, why don't we keep our Bibles open in Exodus 25. There's much the Lord has to teach us from these passages, I promise. We'll pray in a moment, but I don't cry at films. I don't think I've ever cried at a film, but I occasionally get a lump in my throat when watching a few things. You know, the Railway Children. Have you ever seen the Railway Children? You know, that closing scene. The children's father has been in prison for a crime he didn't commit. In the closing scene, the eldest daughter, I think, anyway, she's kind of waiting on the platform, a bit unsure, but just to see if the rumours are true. Is Daddy really coming home? And as the old steam engine is glorious, the old steam engine pulls away and all the other passengers have gone, the steam begins to kind of dissipate and there's this figure stood there. And she realises her father has returned. He's come home. I'll get a lump in my throat as I tell you the story. The Bible has a not too dissimilar story arc, actually, of a family separated, not by false accusation, but by human sin. And ever since Adam and Eve were banished from the Garden of Eden, if you're familiar with the story, whether we realize it or not, all of humanity has been longing to be back home with their father. It's why we all feel, to a greater or lesser extent, and in different ways and in different times, and maybe we'd never articulate it like this, but the Bible says it's true, and we all feel a deep sense of dislocation and rootlessness in this world. Why? Because that perfect relationship that we're meant to have with God was broken by sin. Because we aren't, to put it another way, we aren't home. And we aren't where we're meant to be. It's a spiritual reality that there is no place like home. And so until we get back into relationship with our Heavenly Father, and until he dwells among us, until we live with him, life just won't quite work the way it was meant to. Maybe you feel that keenly this morning. Let's not say we won't have moments of deep joy and peace in this life. We will. God is kind to us. He lavishes us with good things. But ultimately in this life, those moments are fleeting. And even if they're not, they're not ultimately fulfilling. Not least because death brings an end to those things. So far in Exodus, if you've been with us over the last few weeks, Israel have, in a sense, kind of, they've been a bit like a nation on a journey home. On a journey back home. It's a journey to be back with their God in a promised land that he's promised to them, where not only will they be his people in his place, but he'll be their God dwelling amongst them. And here in Exodus 25, though it's not immediately apparent as Chris read it to us, it's not immediately apparent, but Exodus 25 is this high point so far. It's this clearest picture of God's plan to return and dwell amongst his people and the consequences of that for them. I say all of that to say this is a chapter for us this morning. It really is for each and every one of us, whether you'd call yourself a Christian or not, whether you've read the passage before or whether that was the biggest lot of gibberish you've ever heard in your life. The reason why it's for us this morning is because, as Augustine, a famous theologian and bishop, a long time ago said, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you, and until they find their rest in God. That is, we are all by nature homeless, fatherless, and so hopeless, out of relationship with God. So if you feel a bit spiritually restless this morning, then dwelling on the instructions for the building of the tabernacle will be hugely comforting for us, I pray. I bet you didn't think that as Chris read it. I bet you didn't think, oh, this is going to be a really comforting word for me this morning. Why don't we pray that that would be our experience, and then we'll get stuck into it. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we come to your word and we confess so often it seems like it's from another world, for another set of people, and has nothing to say to us. And yet we know that your word is living, that it's alive, that it's written on the hearts of man, that we would hear this and understand it and cling on to it. And so we pray that through my preaching and through the words on this page, you, the living God, would speak hope into our hearts. Amen. I don't know about you, but as I've been prepping this over the last few weeks in Exodus, I couldn't quite believe how much of Exodus was giving over to the tabernacle. We only read one chapter, but we could have been cheeky and read 13 chapters all about the tabernacle. It's so much more compared to Israel's other moments in their history. So you think the first 80 years of Moses' life, about a chapter we had on that. 2.5 chapters describing the Exodus itself as God rescued them from Egypt. Less than a chapter on the Ten Commandments, and now 13 for the tabernacle. Verses 25, if you wanted to kind of just flick through the pages, 25 to 31 are the instruction, if you like, how to build the tabernacle. And then in 25 to 31, and then in 35 to 40 is the implementation. So loads of repetition, obviously, between the instruction and the implementation. And then in the middle, 32 to 34 is a brief interruption, if you like, as God's people decide we know better how to worship God. Thank you very much. We'll come to that next week when we look at the golden calf. But if there was one headline to keep in your mind this morning, it's this, is that the tabernacle functions a bit like a map home. The tabernacle is a map home. It's a map of how God plans to make his dwelling place among his people. And it kind of works, it does that by kind of looking back and looking forward at the same time. Maybe some of it was familiar to you. I think that's because there are so many echoes here of the Garden of Eden. Did you spot the materials used in the construction of the tabernacle? Well, they're the kinds of things that were found in Eden, things that were rich and expensive and just kind of top quality stuff. Even the phrasing, look back to 25 verse 1, the Lord said to Moses, that phrase is repeated 7 times throughout the instructions of how to build the tabernacle. It's the same phrase, if you like, from Genesis, 7 times, and God said at the start of each day. At the end of each kind of construction process, as God built Eden by his word, and then as Moses was told how to build the tabernacle, both end with a Sabbath day. But above all, in both accounts, here are two places where God dwells intimately with his people in a way which actually we haven't seen in between. And that's why it's a tent, not a building. That's what a tabernacle is. It's a tent. Because God is going to dwell amongst his people permanently. He's kind of popped down and they've popped up to the mountain. But very hard to take a mountain with you when you're on the move. So God accommodates himself to them by saying, okay, I'll dwell amongst you in a tent. So you can take me with you. It's like he popped down a couple of times for dinner, but now he's moving in. He's moving into the neighborhood, permanent residence. That's why all the furniture has rings on it and poles. Why? So they can carry it. So the tabernacle is an echo of Eden, if you like. It's a map that kind of looks back to what would have been were it not for human sin. But it's not just something that's familiar for the past, but it's a future truth as well. It's a map that points forward to our eternal home. in Revelation 21. You don't need to be familiar with it. It's the last book of the Bible. And there John is given a vision of what will happen when heaven and earth come together on that final day. It's a vision of the new creation. And with the vision comes the word of God, who says this. He says, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. See, the tabernacle is a map home that not just echoes a bygone era, but points forward to a future reality when God will dwell amongst his people forevermore. And there's so much in these chapters, but for today we're just going to pick out the three bits of furniture that the headings in your translation are given for us. And all of the furniture function a little bit like signposts on the map, signposts that point us forwards to a future reality and that ought to whet our appetites for, oh, I can't wait to be there, and ought to comfort us that those are our realities now if we're in Christ, as we're in relationship with him. And the first one is this. The ark is the home where we live with God. The ark is the home where we live with God in verses 10 to 22. Quite like watching Grand Designs. I'm the only one in my house that does, so I don't get to watch it very often. But, of course, what do? They start with the blueprint and they start with the foundations. No one starts with the furniture. But God here starts with the furniture. Reason being is because the Ark of the Covenant is the most important part of the tabernacle. It's the reason for building everything else. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was this small box, a cubit. It's roughly 18 inches. A cubit, I didn't know this till this week. A cubit is the distance roughly between a man's finger and his elbow. So who knew? All these years of doing DIY, I've been doing it in a very holy way, as I just measured stuff, like roughly, like that with my arm. It says about 45 inches long, 27 inches wide, 27 inches tall. It's not enormous. Had feet to keep it off the ground, and it had rings, like we said, so it could be carried by two poles, made of wood and covered in gold. The proportions aren't incidental or accidental. These are the proportions of a footstool for an ancient king in the ancient Near East. So when a king would sit in judgment, he'd sit on his throne, and he'd put his feet on, I suppose, a footstool. But Israel are not ruled by a human king like that. They're ruled by a God who sits in heaven, and he gives them this ark as a kind of a symbolic footstool, if you like, to help them see that he rules over them and he governs them. You could scribble down Isaiah 6 and 66 if you wanted to see more of that. And what goes inside the Ark of the Covenant is symbolic of how God rules. Did you spot it? Look down at verse 16. He rules by his word. The thing that goes in is the covenant law given to Moses. It's the Ten Commandments. It's not a holy relic, a bit of that blue pavement that we saw a few weeks ago. It's not a picture of God that someone's drawn out. No. God rules by his words. Humanity were banished from the Garden of Eden for rejecting God's word, his law. But in their new home, God seems to be saying, I'll restore it by my word as well. Sure, you broke my law, but through my law, as we saw a few weeks ago with Dan, I'll help you to see that I'm a good God. I'll help you to see the Savior you need. I'll help you to see what Jesus was like. And the lid is a reminder of all of that. Have a little look down at verse 17. The lid there is called an atonement cover. This seems to be something particularly special. This isn't wood overlaid with gold. This is pure gold. And it has two cherubim on it. Last time we saw two cherubim, Garden of Eden, guarding the gates as Adam and Eve were banished. In verse 17 and 19, we see that repeated word cover, a cover for the box. It's nearly always used religiously in Scripture. It's the idea of an atonement. You know, we'd say you have a drink with a friend and you say, don't worry, I'll cover this. Point being, I'll pay the price. That's what atonement is. When Jesus died on the cross, he atoned for our sins. He said, if you trust in me, I'll pay the price, death, that you might have what was mine, perfect righteousness. And the lid here is symbolic for the fact that when we meet God, our sins are covered by the blood of Christ. It's symbolic for the fact that the consequence of breaking the law that should be ours, death, has been fixed by Jesus. ultimately, all of this points forward to a person. Hard to keep the name of Jesus out, isn't it, as we go through this? In the new creation, the function once served by the tabernacle, or by the tent, is served by a person. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in Matthew 1, you think that famous Christmas passage, he tells him, look, Mary's going to bear a son, and he says to him, he's going to be called Emmanuel. What does Emmanuel mean? The angel says it means God with us. John 1:14, John introduces Jesus like this. He says, the Word, that is Jesus, became flesh and made his dwelling place among us. Now, that phrase dwelling place could literally be translated tabernacled. Jesus pitched his tent and tabernacled amongst us, John says. John says, Jesus, the Word, became flesh and tabernacled amongst the people he came to save. And when he did, he made atonement for our sins. He covered us by his mercy. And the Ark of the Covenant points forward to the true Ark, to Jesus. He is the King who laid down his life to make an atonement for our sins. And so in the meantime, as we travel on towards the new creation, it's important that we know that our spiritual home is found not in a place, but a person. And our longing for home is never going to be found kind of geographically or kind of in certain circumstances. It's only ever going to be found in relationship with Jesus. It's spiritual, it's relational. Sure, we love coming to church, but not because the walls are holy or because this time of day is any more special than Wednesday evening or whatever it may be. No, Sundays are special and church is special because we come and we hear God through his word, which points us to Jesus. At the end of Matthew 28, Jesus promises the disciples that he will be with them to the very end of the age. A promise that is, I suppose, we see the first fruits of in Pentecost. He sends the Holy Spirit to live in the hearts of his followers. Now, God can feel far away sometimes, can't he? But if you're a Christian today, he couldn't be closer to you if he tried. God of the universe dwells amongst us as we meet for church, and he dwells in the hearts of the Christian. Maybe you're the only Christian in your office. Well, remember, when that's tough, God dwells in you, and God plus one is always a majority. And maybe you're homebound and watching this on the live stream. Well, remember, God dwells in you. He hears your prayers. As you sit in that doctor's appointment and you feel lonely and isolated, God is with you and he cares deeply for you. We don't need to go anywhere. We don't need to go on a pilgrimage to be in the presence of God. The concept of sacred space is just null and void by the time you get to the New Testament. God used to dwell on a mountain, then in a tabernacle, later in the temple, but today he dwells by his Son in our hearts. So if you're a Christian today, your heart is where God's home is. And the deposit of the Holy Spirit in us will be fully realized one day when we see him face to face. Let's flesh that out a little bit more briefly as we come to our second point, because it can seem a bit distant, can't it? The idea that the home is where we live with God. But see, secondly, the table, because home is where we eat with God. Nothing symbolizes home better than the family table, does it? Maybe where family and friends gather to share a meal. And the table in the tabernacle is the signpost on the map that reminds us that God invites us into family, into fellowship, into community. It points forward to that final day when that eternal banquet will begin, where we spend the rest of eternity with God and his people celebrating together. Now, the table is a bit smaller than the ark, but it's similar in loads of ways. And it's the second most important thing. That's why we get to it second in the order of what God tells Moses. Three things are to go on the table. You spotted them. Plates and dishes of pure gold. Pitchers and bowls for pouring out offerings. And then thirdly and importantly, that this bread of the presence. If you wanted to, later you could flip forward to Leviticus 24. There we learn more about the bread of presence. Here's the gist of it. 12 loaves were placed there once a week to signify the 12 tribes of Israel. Point being, all of God's people, all of the tribes of Israel, are invited into community with him. God welcomes anyone into his family. So important we hear that this morning. And this is striking because what was usual for religious shrines in the ancient Near East was that they used to put out bread for their gods each day, but because they thought that their gods were hungry and they needed to feed their gods. Sounds crazy, but that's what they thought. You know, they really did think that somehow their gods were dependent on them. But the table in the tabernacle communicates the complete opposite. This isn't symbolic of humanity giving bread to God to sustain him. No, it's the opposite. Here is the holy God acting as the host, saying, I don't need anything from you, but I've come to give. I've come to feed you. The priest would eat the bread once a week to symbolize that, that they were the recipients on behalf of God's people that understood all our blessings come from God. He needs us for nothing. We need him for everything. It's important to remember that when we think back to the cross, I think, that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they didn't need us. They weren't lonely. They'd been in perfect loving fellowship for all eternity. But because of their love for us, Jesus came and laid down his life, forfeiting that eternal relationship as he hung on the cross, so that we might have what they've always had, so that we might get brought into the table to enjoy the community that they've always enjoyed. And they weren't lacking in any way. They didn't need us. But God wanted us there because he loves us. And all we have to do is come to him, Jesus says. John 6, verse 35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never grow hungry. The table in the tabernacle points towards that eternal banquet, where one day we'll feast in the presence of God. We got a glimpse of that last week. A feast that is symbolic of the fact that we will never want for anything evermore. Just dwell on that as an idea, even if you don't believe it or trust it yet. An eternal banquet where you will never want for anything forevermore. If you're a Christian today, you will never grow hungry. We pray that in the Lord's Prayer, give us today our daily bread. He won't necessarily give us everything we ask for, but either he will or he'll give us something better, because he promises to give us everything we need. We will not look back from the other side of eternity and look back at this life and have if buts and maybes and regrets. I wish God had done. No. God gives us everything we need as he welcomes us into fellowship with him. Home is a place where we eat with God and we'll never grow hungry forevermore. And we see that clearly via the lamp. And the home is a place where we walk in the light of God. And finally, this lampstand, you kind of see them in churches sometimes. No, I don't think we've got one, or it might be in a cupboard somewhere. You see these kind of, they've got the trunk, if you like, in the middle, the stem, and then there's six kind of branches coming off of it. And it's the picture of kind of spiritual perfection. If you look down, it's described in a bit of a confusing way, but this is the gist of it. You had kind of one trunk, three branches either side, and then three cups shaped like flowers off each of the six. So there's 18 of those. And then off the lampstand in the middle of the trunk, you had kind of four buds. So 18 plus four, 22. You've got 22 kind of wicks, candles filled with oil, and kind of a little wick in the middle. It's no coincidence that it looks like a tree. Of course, what is it? It's an echo back to the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. And it's a signpost forward to the tree of life in the new creation. It's symbolic of what we've alluded to already, that life is found in relationship with God. And then until we have a relationship with God, we'll feel restless. Life won't work. And this life, good though it is, will end in death. But not this life. And it's also symbolic of light. Its function was to illuminate the tabernacle on the table. elsewhere we read that this lamp was to be to lit twice. So the priest would go in and they'd kind of sort it out in the morning and sort it out in the evening as well. Point being, it was to permanently light the tabernacle. Why? Well, to show that God really is home, and that he dwells amongst his people. We were away on holiday this week, so we thankfully went around for all the, you know, the trick-or-treaters and things like that. But of course, what would I have done if I was here? I would have closed the curtains and I'd have turned the lights off and I'd have sat in a back room watching telly in the dark, just so that nobody knew I was there. I'd want to signify, I'm not home, no point knocking on this door. Of course, what do you do if you go to a house and you see all the lights on? You go, oh, so-and-so's home. This was the reason for the lamp. Is keeping the lamp lit was a permanent reminder to the Israelites as they traveled in this kind of camping community. As they moved, there would always been a glow from the middle of the tabernacle, almost like a spiritual kind of nightlight. Maybe your kids have those, just to comfort them. Maybe they couldn't sleep, they come out of their tent and they see the glow and they're reminded, okay, whatever I'm going through, whatever I'm facing, God dwells with us. God is home. He's come down. He's made his dwelling place amongst us. What a comfort that would have been as they went on that journey. And what a comfort to us in a dark world to know that in Christ, we have the ultimate light who came into this world to show us God and to show us all that we have in relationship with him. In John 8:12, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus is the true light of the world. He is the light of God in whom we walk. Incidentally, that is kind of, it's the reason why people sometimes find it hard to become Christians. Maybe if you're grappling with that this morning, it's often for the fact that Jesus is light, that he shines light into our hearts, and so he exposes things that we're ashamed of, and it kind of, hearing the Bible's teaching kind of stirs up in us things that we don't like. And so what do? Well, we want to ignore the light. But Jesus says, don't do that. Don't do that. Come to the light. Don't shield yourself from the light, because Jesus come not to judge but to save. And if we repent of the pride that says, there's nothing in here that I don't mind people know, if we say, no, Lord, look, I'm a wretched sinner, I need saving because of these things, well, of course, he pays the price for that. He heals us of our sin. And so there's nothing left to hide. Because when God looks at me, he sees his son's perfect righteousness. As we close, each and every one of us here this morning were born to live in the presence of God. We were born to have God dwell in our hearts. We were made in his image to spend an eternity with him. Like Adam and Eve, we forfeit that by our sin and rebellion. But God loves us enough that he came to dwell amongst us, not least as he sent his son to make it possible that we could come back to him. Our longing for a home, that restlessness we feel in this life, that is a blessing from God. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes that eternity is written on the human heart. And deep down, we know that. We know that this life was never meant to satisfy. Though we love our families and we take pride in our careers and we're thankful for the material blessings that we have, deep down, it's a good thing that we know that they don't quite do the job for us. It's why maybe you're looking into the Christian faith this morning. It's why countless people around the world are looking for God. And yet God knew that we couldn't work our way back to him as if we could do good things to trump the bad things. No, he knew he would need to come down and dwell amongst us if we were to have the home that our hearts desire. And in the tabernacle, we see signpost after signpost that points forward to Christ, our Emmanuel, our God come down, who tabernacled among us, died for our sin and sent his Holy Spirit to live in our hearts, a deposit that one day we'll spend an eternity with him. Now, he's the true ark. Is the one in whom God's glory is clearly revealed. Just read one of the New Testament Gospels, see that for yourself. He's the true bread, the one in whom our hearts are just made full. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Keep coming to church, try it on, see what you think. And he's the true lamp. He's the one who reveals not only the state of our hearts, but the way back to God. Dwell on it. think, is this true? Does this make sense to me? There are great comforts in Exodus 25 for the Christian, and I take it a great encouragement as well for those who wouldn't yet call themselves Christians, that all of this is offered to all people made in God's image. Let me pray, and then we're going to sing. Heavenly Father, we praise you for Jesus. We praise you that the God of the universe came and dwelt among us, that he might bring us back to our Heavenly Father. And we thank you for the richness of the Old Testament that points forward to who Jesus was. And we thank you for how the story holds together to help us to see that this really is true. It holds up under scrutiny and it's worth believing and trusting in. And we thank you that in Jesus we have all we need, safety, security, light, satisfaction and joy. Might you keep us going on the journey until we see him face to face and celebrate with him for all eternity. Amen.